have a grain and dairy operation. Our core business is dairy. And actually this morning you heard from my mother, Marion. We're a multi-generational operation with both my parents, Ed and Marion, and my wife and I, Megan. We have been in Chestertown since 1960. Our core business has and still is dairy farming. And then it was the late 90s, about 1998, when we started transitioning to organic. And we started with our tillable acres. And it is just this year that we are finally making the big leap and we're transitioning our dairy herd. Actually here, the 31st of this month will be our official start date for transition on our dairy. We have been, as I say, growing organic grain since the late 90s. Our entry into the marketplace was due in fact to Horizon. When their dairy moved into the Kennedyville area, we helped them secure some of their permitting for that operation and then began transitioning ground to grow feed, forage feed, for that dairy. Over the years, that has evolved, and through the early 2000s, we had a very large customer base in southeast Pennsylvania, specifically with the Amish organic dairies for our grain. And then here in the last 5 years, Purdue has become a very large player in the marketplace and a very large buyer of ours. We've also worked with Boyd's Mill that was up here earlier today, Boyd Station. Both of them have been very good buyers that we've dealt with. And now with this change of our dairy, it's really shifting the emphasis of our operation. Where we have been a grower of cash grains on the organic market for sale, and our conventional acres were going through our dairy, with this change we've decided to enroll all of our acres, transition all of our acres over. And it's really not about diversifying for us, but about consolidation. We're moving to an entirely all organic operation where we will be putting all of our production through our dairy cows for value added with organic milk sales. The one caveat I guess I would say to that is we do have a small grass-fed beef herd that is not organic, and right now we're using that beef herd to graze transition pasture acres before we can use them for our dairy cattle. As I said in the past, we've been a diversified ag business. We did conventional grains, conventional milk. We had organic, both forage in alfalfa hay and organic grains. We've also had the grass-fed and finished beef cattle, and we've done custom forage harvesting and other custom farming. And we're taking this focus. We see a lot of opportunity in organic. We don't have the volatility in the marketplace that we see in conventional, and that's really what's driven us to this model. I'd like to touch quickly, when Steve from Coleman Foods was up here this morning, there's two things that he hit on that really struck home with me and I thought were really important. One of that is what he felt was the safety of conventional food and the healthiness of it. And I want to echo that sentiment because we've been in conventional milk for a long time and we do believe that we produce a very high quality product. But we also believe when we're in the organic marketplace that we have the same opportunity to provide a very highly nutritious and safe product. And quality is very important to us as we look at our operation. The other thing that he touched on that I don't think can be missed is the integrity, because integrity is really what drives the organic model. There's opportunity out there for people to take advantage of the system, and quite often there's skepticism from other conventional producers, but I think integrity is what the organic industry has to hang its hat on. And for us, that's something that really hits home, is integrity and then producing the highest quality product that we can. And Jenny, if you're ready for one of the other guys, I know I probably didn't use my 10 minutes, but I'll be much happier to answer questions.
Any volunteers? Come on, Evan. Okay, thanks, Matt. All right, Evan Miles is here, and they do grains and vegetables, correct?
Okay. Thank you, Jenny. Morning, my name is Evan Miles, third generation farmer in Queen Anne's County. We till about 3,500 acres conventional in on the shore here, and about 160 organic. Matt brought up a lot of good points about the integrity of organic farming, and we emphasize that exclusively with the organic. I was thinking about it earlier. I was thinking, I'm a veteran of organic farming, even though we've only been doing it for 8 years. It's been doing it since actively growing grain crops since 2008. So it's been quite a challenge to learn and understand. But I overheard someone talking earlier while I was walking around, and they said that organic farming today isn't much different from the farming they used to do in the past. So it's I've thought about that. My grandfather said that a lot of times. He said, well, we used to cultivate, and we used to rotary hoe, we used to moldboard plow, and that's all we're doing right now is with the organic. And you know, you got quite a bit more challenges now with the organic, with erosion and trying to take care of the bay and the health of the rivers. So it's a whole different mindset, which I'm excited to be a part of. We've learned a lot over the years. We've grown with a lot of growers. Like we started growing last year with Ken Bartosh at Hanover Food, so we're excited to work together. The organic community is very small, and most of the people that are here I know and work collaboratively with a lot. We kind of go back and forth. You know, agriculture community as a whole is pretty small, but a lot of the people I work with organic, we toss around to each other ideas and how do we go about fixing these things, and we work together trying to make a profitable business. With that said, I'm happy to work with Spencer Miller at Boyd Station as well. We used to deal with basically organic unlimited, so it was tough to figure out where to market our grains. But now that Purdue and Spencer, we got a rapport with them, so it's exciting to be able to market your grains with several different suppliers or buyers. Sorry, it's grown tremendously in the last 8 years. Some people would think it would be glacial as far as movement, but I've seen a lot of growth in the organic market. A lot of people, it's hard to take on, and we can kind of talk about it through questions and some of the challenges. And I'm excited to be here to represent the organic community and Eastern Shore. So thank you.
So Andrew has evidently volunteered to go next. So this is Andrew McLean. He's a poultry farmer in Queen Anne's County. Thanks, Andrew.
Well, thank you, Jenny. So I'm a brand new organic chicken rancher. I apologize, my ponytail hasn't grown in yet. I've been growing chickens for close to 10 years now, and I always try to look at things and think about what the customer wants. And if this is the way that the marketplace is going, that's what I wanted to be a part of. Timing was part of it. Purdue was with the Coleman purchase and moving down this way. The Milford plant is the closest plant to me. The Herlock feed mill is about the closest feed mill to me. And we're in the upper area and away from a lot of other poultry farms, so that's good from a disease standpoint. So the timing was good. What I was seeking to do, in part, was making more income from the same houses without having to put in, you know, additional housing. And then as far as the work went, it worked. That part played well into what I wanted to do, because it's a little bit more work every day, but it's not as much work on the end, because the birds move out a little bit faster than they did with the roasters. My interest, as Marion said, I always, in the back of my mind, think about what I learned in college, and that is innovators make a lot of money, but they go bust a lot too, and I don't ever want to be there. It's the early adopters that tend to get the best of both worlds, and I try to be on, think about, you know, where am I on that early adopting curve. I like to be precise. I like to do a good job. I work very hard at that, and I think that organic rewards you for that precision, and as other people have said, for that integrity. It's a little bit different, not tremendously different than growing conventional birds. Of course, you can't spray. Rodent control has been a big concern of mine, and still haven't quite figured out how we're going to do all of that, but I don't like mice and rats. That's our problem. It's not weeds, it's the rodents around poultry farm. And of course, getting used to the birds, because they are a little different. They let their feathers grow long, and it's hard to get them to take a shower. But in general, it's you know, the same thing. It's just trying to be a little bit more precise, more paperwork to go along with it. But in my long experience of one flock, I've enjoyed it very much, and I look forward to being part of this for the ongoing future. Thank you.
Now we have a husband and wife team, Steve and Kate. So are you both going to come up? Okay, good. All right. So they're farmers also in Queen Anne's County, and they have grain and vegetables. They have a lot of different operations. So.
Good morning. Steve and I are, yes, both on our family farm. If you've attended this meeting in the past, you probably know my dad, Bill Mason. He's spoken here before. The farm's been on our family since about 1890, mainly a grain farm. We've also had dairy at point, hogs. We've grown for canneries, mainly conventional, always conventional, until my dad transitioned back in 2006. And moved on from there, and we've got just about our whole farm transitioned now, about just over 600 acres, and we also lease 5 other farms as well as our own. Only one of those conventional, the rest are organic as well. And I guess 2 years ago, my husband started working for my dad full time, and
it's been a long 3 years.
3 years, sorry. I actually worked for the Department of Agriculture out of college, and in 2011 decided that I wanted to come back to, was ready to come back to the family farm. My parents were ready to turn over our produce business, and so that's what I manage. I manage our retail produce market. Everything that we grow at our market, we grow as naturally as possible. We have not certified our high tunnels or the small amount of land that we have for our produce business. Our retail market, my parents started that in 1988, and besides our local customers, a lot of our customers are coming from Virginia and DC. We get a lot of beach traffic, as with the integrity, a lot of people trust our word. They know exactly what we're doing. We explain to them any organic fertilizers, chemicals that we use on our farm. So we've not taken the step to actually certify the small amount we use for vegetables, but it's gone over very well. Our customers have been very happy with what we're growing. We diversified into, we carry local milk, cheeses, eggs, breads from Mr. Lapp is sitting there in the front row from his bakery. It's gone over very well. If Steve wants to talk a little bit about the transition to organic, and I'm terrible with speaking anyway, and he can ramble for a minute about the grain production.
Thanks, Kate. I just want to pick up real quick where Andrew left off on mentioning about organic farmers as early adapters. And I said, early adapters, that's great. And I thought, well, early adapters and early adopters. Organic farmers seem to be on the forefront of a lot of new things. A few things that come to mind, it comes down to creating opportunities. When I think about when Andrew also mentioned, you know, he wanted to be part of a market that's becoming popular and has a lot of promise. It's not just for just to find it's not only a way of living. It's not just for a niche market. It's also just, it provides, as I see it, opportunities for the organic community in several different ways. My father-in-law Bill, he's always been at the forefront of the any organic farming techniques and the entire movement since 2006, when he decided to start transitioning, or his first fields actually came out of transition, I believe. He's cultivated many connections in academia. He surrounded himself with innovators and farmers, researchers, University of Maryland, Penn State, Rodale Institute, and Wye Research Institute. I'm constantly meeting and talking to people he's known for many years, and I'm starting to work with them more and understand where they fit in with our operation and organic farming in general. I've witnessed the farm expand, adapt, and innovate. I'm very grateful to have been part of this process so far since moving here in late 2008. And that process continues to the day. This one thing that's been hit on by several of the speakers so far is the learning. It's a challenge and an opportunity, but it never stops those challenges. I believe they foster new questions, which causes you to look for new solutions, understand new concepts, realize the outcomes and the opportunities that all those different things afford. Just to keep going, one opportunity I see, I'm working with, we're currently working on right now is cover crops. They're essential, if not paramount, to sustainable organic farming. So many different species for different purposes. We've been using, there's a lot of different players out there, and folks we've learned from, working with. A lot of people out there know a lot more about cover crops than I certainly do. I've attended a lot of sessions, webinars, presentations, and events and field days. But there's such a host of information out there, and there's a lot of help for those of you out there, and help for even us as we move forward. A name comes up to mind, Steve Groff in Pennsylvania, his cover crop solution company and his cocktail mixes. Working with Stephen Mirsky and Michelle Cavagelli, who are here today. We've been working closely with them on many different no-till solutions and systems for weed suppression and fertility and for different uses like that. Even also with Dave Wilson at King Agriseed, I saw him here today. Working with him, getting ideas from him, trying things out, and then asking more questions, adopting practices, and it marches on. We've expanded from using, currently our traditional toolkit as far as field management. You look at like the moldboard plow and rippers and chisel plows, harrows, cultivators, et cetera, and discs. Right now, that's our dominant reliance on these traditional field management practices. Although I think we're looking for a way to invert that reliance from the heavy tillage to a more reduced tillage focus, expanding our toolkit using tine harrows, flamers, which we've purchased for weed control, looking into strip tillage, having a roller crimper, no-till cultivation, even grit blasters that can blast the seeds with cornmeal grit, equipment for interseeding and relay cropping. They're just new field management ideas that we're looking into, thinking about experimenting with, and we'd rather rely on those techniques and have those dominate our production management scheme as opposed to maybe some of these older traditional cultural practices. But and just another quick note on where I believe we're moving into is our technology toolkit. What we're using today, we're looking into some of this new nitrogen modeling software. Right now, I think specifically for corn production, but we're looking to see if we can adapt that to an entire organic rotation to see how nutrients are flowing, how they're being mineralized, how they're being taken up, where there's demand, how you time your applications of nutrients, using the four R's of nutrient management, right place, time, form, and the rate, and incorporating all those different pieces together is my goal, and I believe it's everyone's goal, everyone in this room, every producer here. It's just moving forward and learning these new techniques and trying to apply them, adapt and adopt. It's probably the easiest way to put it. I just want to say really quick, just as a thank you to Jenny for the invitation to participate on the panel. She spearheaded this event, and she's behind a lot of the work that makes this possible. I think she's a fantastic resource to us and a champion of the agriculture community. I think we're very lucky to have her, and just want to thank her again for that. Thank you, Jenny. I think that's all I had to say. Do you have anything else to add? Thank you very much.
Thank you, Steve. That's very kind. Okay, I need some questions. I don't have many questions out here, so let's have some more questions. But okay, what type of financial resources have been available to each one of you to transition to organic or for your organic operation? Have you met any resistance when trying to find resources?
I'll take a stab at this first off. For us, NRCS has been a great resource. With us looking at transitioning our dairy herd, you're getting away from traditional row crop. You're looking at a lot more pasture-based system and forage crops. And there's a lot of funding available out there through the EQIP program, through MAX within the state, for fencing projects, for water travel lanes. If you have your planning available, they will work with you to help you fund those projects. As Terry Ingram stated when he was up here, within dairy, many of the different buyers for milk will offer incentives to help herds transition through up front. And then also from our more traditional lending, we do a lot of work with Farm Credit, and Farm Credit has really encouraged us with our pursuit of organic and have backed us well with that. They see the opportunity there to differentiate ourselves and not just be the price taker of the conventional commodity market.
Okay. Anybody else? You might as well take it out, Steve.
A quick note on financial assistance that we've received. When I first came to Maryland after meeting my wife and moving down here, a few acres that my father-in-law, Bill, was transitioning. Actually, he was using a NRCS organic transition program where they paid him a certain rate per acre and to keep it and had to be planted in a certain mix of grass and a legume, I believe, for 3 years. Of course, no nutrients applied or anything. Basically, just a fallow field with that growing on it, and it paid him a certain rate. Of course, after the 3 years was up, he was able to push it into organic grain production. So I know that's helped him directly, and what helps us every year is the cover crop program through MDA, since I did mention cover crops, and I was talking about all the good they do and how they are essential for organic producers, at least organic vegetable and grain producers. Their programs have allowed us to cost share on putting down cover crops for, say, legumes for our corn production. It's where we'll grow our legumes, and we'll put down a certain rate based on the recommendations, and we'll have those legumes grow, and that nitrogen will turn into the soil in the spring for our corn crop to feed the corn crop and provide some nitrogen there, instead of being totally reliant on, poultry litter. But those are just a couple quick examples I just wanted to give. Thank you.
And I'll just reinforce what Steve said earlier, as far as in the transition for the poultry houses. Coleman has held the cost at 0%, and they're taking it out over 5 years.
Good, good, good. Okay. All right. Let's see. Let's go to this one. What type of impact does organic practices have on your nutrient management plan? And more specifically, how does manure play into your plan? And I guess they want to know about phosphorus levels too. So, who wants to start? All right, Steve, you gonna start?
Yeah.
Okay.
Can you just repeat the question one more time, Jenny?
There's okay, they wanna know what type of impacts on organic practices, and then part of your nutrient management plan. So I guess talk to them about maybe your nutrient management plan and how you fill those N, P, and K requirements. And then if you use manure, how does that play into your?
Yeah, so as far as organic production, there's no conventional fertilizers allowed, although we have had some help working with our agri-service dealer, Willard's. I believe they're here today, and working with Jim Smith, and he's been looking into new solutions for organic operations and looking for organic nutrient sources, which has gone over pretty well for us. We've been very happy working with him and still continue to work with him. on trying new things. Primarily, though, for nutrient management to provide nutrients, especially for our corn, the most nutrient-intensive thus far. Poultry litter is still the main nitrogen supply for it. I did mention the legumes. That has changed how the nutrient management plan is, how I've adapted the nutrient management plan. We do have to understand when we're plowing in the nitrogen, how much is there, how much biomass, then we can convert that to an actual number per acre, and based on certain estimates of what's going to be available out of that total number, which is roughly around 50%, we've been able to get up to 75-80 pounds of predicted available nitrogen from that legume cover crop, but usually the other half, if not a little more, is provided by the manure. And to speak on the phosphorus issue that can be an issue coming from the manure, usually we do try to source manure that has at least the same amount of nitrogen as it does phosphorus, or at least that they're fairly close. But one thing we try to keep the same every year or every 2 years through our crop rotation is whatever phosphorus we put on, usually with the manure, is taken off by the other crops. So the crop removal from the corn, perhaps the small grains such as barley and the soybeans, will remove any of that phosphorus that's added to the field. So that's what we try to keep a close eye on. We always keep a close eye on our soil test phosphorus, and especially these days with the phosphorus management tool and the new regulations, that's something we're certainly cognizant of. So thank you.
I think it's a really good question. I'd say it's a challenge, and I thought when the panel was up here before, maybe one of the missed opportunities they had was for the biggest challenges, and I think fertility is one of those challenges. Mm-hmm. Because our best source of the nitrogen that we need, especially for crops like corn, is going to come through manure, whether that's chicken litter, dairy manure. Those are going to be the big ones in this area. And for most of the guys and people in this room, it'd be looking at chicken litter. Now, that being said, if you've got manure, you've got phosphorus there as well. And you cannot separate those two, or with the technology that's out there today, not do it cost effectively. And as Steve mentioned, Willard's is putting a lot of time and a lot of research into what options are out there. And they're really developing, I think, what's going to be a good program. And they're putting a lot of effort into it. And we've done some work with them as well. Today, we haven't quite hit the point where it's been the most cost effective when we look at our bottom line relative to the results. But we're confident they've got smart people on it, and they're going to get it figured out, and they're going to get it right. For our individual operation, we rely heavily on manure, and we're in a very intensive system with our dairy. One of the advantages we have with the dairy is our manure is more balanced from an N and P ratio relative to crop need when compared to chicken litter, which is a huge advantage to us. The disadvantage we have with dairy manure is volume. It's not quite as dense as what chicken litter is, and we just handle a tremendous amount of volume relative to what a chicken house is going to put out. And that makes exporting that manure very difficult. So on our home operation, our home base is about 650 acres. We only use dairy manure there because we do not want to run the risk of bringing in outside phosphorus from chicken litter when dairy is our core business. On property that's removed from there, then we will use chicken litter because of logistics and trucking. But we also run a very intensive crop rotation with our dairy. We have the ability that we're not just selling corn and beans. We're in the business of feeding cows. That takes grain. That takes an immense amount of forage. So we're able to pull more back off the land, and that helps keep our nutrient levels in check on that ground. I mean, we're looking at ground that's had cows on it continuously for the last 55 years, and we're not running into that phosphorus threshold, but that's because of what we're taking back off that ground. Mm-hmm. The cattle give us the ability that we're not just harvesting a single crop in corn. We're harvesting that cover crop for forage in the spring. We're harvesting corn. we can go in with alternative crops that we have a market for, such as alfalfa, and that really helps build that nitrogen level in the soil. I mean, for in our operation, there's no doubt our best corn crop comes after alfalfa comes out. But we have that market for the alfalfa because we're able to put it through the cows.
Good. Evan?
Great job to Steve and Matt covering those subjects. I don't have a whole lot more additional to add. It's just more of reemphasizing some of the stuff that they brought up. One of the things that is critical, and Matt hit right on it. When they asked about the number one concern, my number one concern was immediately fertility. You got a weed problem, but fertility and trying to grow a crop each year is the most difficult challenge. We've struggled. It's at the forefront of our mind, and we've struggled to produce a crop that is always profitable because of the fertility. So a lot of times we'll have to take into consideration how much manure to put on based on the soil samples and the soil test, and we keep a close eye on the phosphorus level because it can go up quickly based on the type of soil you have and how much phosphorus is already in that soil and type of soil structure. So it's you have to keep an open mind on where you want to put. If you're interested in putting organic fields, you kind of strategically want to think about the type of farms you would want to put them in and put organic ones. You have to take that in consideration. It's the biggest concern of mine, and some of the strategies that Steve and Matt have mentioned we're attempting to implement. We do cover crop each year after the spring crop comes off, so we help utilize the nutrients in the fall and in the spring, help take off some of the excess nitrogen and phosphorus. So we're trying to get more involved in that. As far as the nutrient management plan and some of the stuff that Willard is offering, we also have been in contact with Willard AgriService, and they're actually offering a no-phos fertilizer. So it's something that we're going to keep in mind while we're continuing to fight the battle. When we're growing the peas, we kind of have a struggle figuring out how to get the fertilizer out there effectively to utilize. So you can't really, because of regulation, you can't put the manure out there on a ground crop. So it has to be pelletized litter, which can be a little bit more costly, and it's a lot more to handle, and so it's a struggle to do that. Also, with the peas, I've been in contact and talked to other people. You don't know if you actually get the benefit of the chicken litter and pellets right off the bat. So, but it can also be used for the secondary crop afterwards. But definitely the biggest challenge for organic farmer, I think, is the fertility.
Okay. Andrew, you want to talk a little bit about your nutrient management plan and where your manure goes, and maybe do you utilize Maryland manure transportation program?
Well, my nutrient management plan has been and continues to be no land plan with poultry houses, so I'm exporting all of my chicken litter. There is no change in that from going from conventional to organic. There's no particular difference there as far as I know, and nobody has said that there's going to be any difference. The farmers that I sell to, some of them do use the manure transport program. Some don't, but that's kind of up to them. The way that I sell it is, you know, loaded on their truck at the farm.
Okay.
But no difference.
Okay. Matt, have you used manure transportation through the Maryland Department of Ag?
Yes, we have used the manure transportation. We use it both for dairy liquid and for chicken litter. I will say for anybody in the department that's here, it's a program that we do value. We really do value. We sure would like it if they could get it a little more streamlined, like Delaware's program. At times, it can be a lot of paperwork and slow payment, but it is a program that is valuable to the state and to the farmers.
Okay. Anybody else want to chime in? Okay. Matt, this question was for you. Will the transition of your herd really change the way that you manage your herd?
Yes, it has a very profound impact on us. So for years now, we've been a conventional confinement herd. We have pushed our cows for high production, quality milk, and I don't want to make any bones about it. You only get high production from dairy cattle through good health. There's lots of misconceptions out there, but high production is a result of good health. They're not mutually exclusive of each other. You have to have health to get production. The biggest change that we're going to see out of this is the NOP requirement for pasturing. We have to hit 30% of our dry matter intake on those cows to qualify for certified organic. So those cows will be coming out, going on to pasture during the growing season. And obviously, once we put an acre into pasture, it is our goal to maximize that return on that acre just like any other. So we want to get the cows out there and get that forage. Another big change it's going to have is in how we deal with sick cows. And certainly sick cows are the exception. They're not the rule. For the majority of our herd, it'll have very little impact from a cow health standpoint. We will have some cows that are going to require attention, that are going to cause them to leave the organic program. The NOP states very clearly in the rules that you cannot withhold treatment for an animal. But once you do treat that animal, they will leave the program and no longer be certified organic. So for us, in that aspect, the grazing, that really changes. But the core stays the same, and it's back to basics. Get the basics right, have healthy cows, and the cows are going to take care of the rest.
Okay, good. Okay, I think this question can be answered by each one of you. So we're talking about costs. They want to know, you know, when you were doing conventional farming, no matter what it was, what are your costs now as an organic producer compared to conventional?
So everybody's costs are a little bit different on production, and I'll do it as a percentage. On our corn ground, we figure our cost per acre to grow organic corn is lower than that of our conventional corn. And I'm going to sit here and say that we're probably looking at about 80% the cost per acre to grow our organic grain that we do with the conventional. Now, that being said, we also have a yield lag there, and we typically figure it's about a 20% yield lag on a normal year. However, the delta is the cost of the price you receive for your product, which is significant. You know, we've been doing this since the late 90s, and we've seen years where it's been as close as a 2-to-1 relationship, and we've seen years where that income or that price per bushel has been as high as 4-to-1. But we definitely see a lower cost per acre. And so that translates on a per bushel basis, even with the yield lag, to be very comparable. As we transition our dairy herd, it depends whether you're taking opportunity cost into account. We're going to be on a per 100 weight of milk. We're going to be in the same ballpark as we are now, maybe slightly higher, but our opportunity is much greater. Even when you take into account opportunity costs, we feel that we've got the opportunity to add real value even above the value that guys like Chris from Purdue was sitting up here talking about today.
Okay, good. How about on the vegetable side? Evan, you want to talk about the vegetable inputs?
Well, with the implementation of peas last year into our operation, it was a bit of a struggle because it was a new venture for both the farmers that were involved as well as Hanover Foods. It was very exciting to work together and accomplish it, but we renegotiated some terms to be able to make a better profit per cost better profit per acre this year than we did last. It was kind of we participated in pea growing organically, I think in 2010, and we made some profit off of it. As far as versus the conventional side of peas versus the organic side of peas, like Matt says, it's comparable. You don't have the cost of pesticide, herbicide, that type of thing, but you have kind of more of a lot more of the cost as far you don't see really a tangible cost as far as like an input like a chemical or a fertilizer or a some type of seed, but rather than like it's the labor, it's a lot more labor intensive. So you'll see like I said, it's comparable, but you'll have a lot higher labor costs because you have to go over the field a lot more time. So I think that's just that also goes with the grain. You'll see you have to go over the field multiple times, and if you don't really take into consideration your labor, yeah, you do make a good profit. I just want to add that last year we had we're in a 50-50 with a landowner who's here today, and we had a fantastic year as far as growing corn. So our profit per acre was great considering what we've had in years past. So we were very excited about that, and I guess it was about 3 years ago, maybe 2012, we had a really great crop of corn that year too. So it's based on your fertility needs and things like that, and just kind of how the rotation falls. You're going to have a lot better years than other years, but very excited about what we did last year. It was kind of when you kind of figure up the tickets and look at it, you like kind of do a double take and really did we do that? And then yeah, we did. So good. It's exciting, and you can definitely make a good profit off of organic.
Good. So Evan, I'm hearing you say that the company was willing to work with you and look at your cost and kind of evaluate that in comparison to their contract.
You talked to me?
Yeah.
Sorry. Can you say it again?
So were the company that you were dealing with, they were willing to listen to you about with your cost and all, and kind of go back and reevaluate some things.
Yeah. We thought that we were instrumental in trying to negotiate a proper contract and a proper profit per acre for both the grower and the producer. So it was a lot of work involved and a lot of legwork to try and figure up what would be a fair profit for both. And we came to a good term, and a lot of other growers had a conversation right before the meeting that another one of the pea growers appreciated the fact that we helped negotiate the terms and got a better price per acre. It's a learning curve for everybody. It's difficult to manage, but we felt like it was a fair profit for both companies.
Okay, good. Andrew, have you seen any difference?
The primary thing with the poultry was the conversion cost, which was around $18,000 a house, and that's for the windows, for the pasture, fencing, doors for them to go in and out, and the entertainment centers inside the chicken house.
They're environmental rich enrichments.
Yes. So you have that extra cost. Again, that's being taken out over five flocks. And then the only other major expense or different expense would be going away from spraying around the chicken house twice a year and mowing four or five times a year to last summer. It felt like I was mowing every week and paying some guys to come in with weed eaters to get rid of the weeds. But that's primarily, it's a little bit more labor time expense on that. But otherwise, it's about the same.
Okay. Kate and Steve?
From the produce perspective for the retail market, I'd say we're definitely doing better organically than we were conventionally. We're much more preventative now. We spray once a week, every 2 weeks with certain fungicides to prevent anything from taking over our garden, as opposed to before we really mainly sprayed when we saw bugs or pests or something was really going wrong. So we're much more preventative mindset instead now. But I'd say probably the largest thing that's helped us out is our high tunnels. We currently have two high tunnels that we grow. Last year we grew tomatoes in them, as well as other vegetables, squashes, microgreens, et cetera. This year we're dedicating both of our high tunnels to tomatoes. That's really where our biggest profit margin is, besides our corn. If we could really probably have one more high tunnel, that would probably be what we really need on our farm to kind of set us up, because the tomatoes in the high tunnel, they do really well, knock on wood. We have not had a problem with pests in there. We have not had a problem with disease. We've been very vigilant about rotating our crops inside the high tunnels and whatnot. And so I think for that reason, we've definitely proved better on the organic side than on the conventional side for the produce market.
Yeah, and just to add on to what my wife said, back about the high tunnels, they have been a great resource to us. Actually, they reduce labor and time spent fooling around with the crops. You don't have to, you control the irrigation with drip tape, or we do. Fertility, we run right through the drip tape, so we fertigate. It makes it very easy. Management is much less so than outside. But as Kate was mentioning about spraying, I mean, we've transitioned from using a conventional herbicide, pesticides and like fungicides to organic ones, hence, doing more preemptive spraying from the get-go, light amount, very small amounts all the way through up to a certain point, of course, still trying to follow what the label says at all times, but getting a head start on any pest has been really key for us, and actually probably preventing or probably helping us with our management and reducing our management, but also just to as far as the grain business, I'd like basically what Evan said. I'd mirror like his comments almost exactly. I'd like just to make a comment about the tillage and the equipment. And I made a quick reference to what kind of tillage equipment we use now: mold board plows and chisel plows, sometimes rippers, etc. But being organic, it seems like you've got to add to your toolbox or your toolkit the different kinds of equipment you really need. It's almost, there's many different scenarios out there for a different type of year or different crop. If it's a dry year, wet year, cold year, early, late, you name it. It seems like you've got to spend a little more in equipment, or at least try equipment if you can find somebody with it, and you've got to try it out. And of course, if you find something that works, that's something you probably would consider buying. That field work definitely, yes, is a higher cost in organic, and also not to mention management and just keeping an eye on your crops in general, talking with your agri-service rep, your fertilizer man, and keeping up to speed with them as the year progresses and things change, and you got to adapt and adopt.
Steve, while you're talking, I'll let you continue. I have a question. What experience do you have with no-till or minimum-till production of corn or soybeans, and how is it compared to kind of the conventional tillage that you might do?
No-till. We've had some mixed success with the soybeans. We found that in order to have a good weed suppression from your cover crop, typically it's rye. You need to establish your cover crop as early as you can, which then kind of, when you back up and you look at it, you say, well, that means I guess I got to have my crop in a little earlier. And we've been caught in certain cases on certain farms in a certain cycle where it's a vicious cycle, where if you're late 1 year with the crop getting planted, whether it was weather or some other reason, you're going to be late in your cover crops, and they don't have the opportunity to grow and produce that biomass, especially for soybeans, where you can roll down that rye, cover up the ground, and drill right through that vegetative mat into the ground and have the soybeans germinate and hopefully beat out the weeds, and plus, of course, that cover crop provides some shade to keep the weeds at bay. Jenny, what was the second part of that? The questions of no-till? And
I just compared to, you know, the conventional tillage that you would do. What, I mean, do you have any thought between one or the other, or is it?
I definitely prefer the no-till soybean drilling into a cover crop. We're starting to learn. We've seen that there's two ways we can do it. We can either roll down that rye and either drill into it, which is about a 7.5-inch spacing. Although once that's done, there's no option for any tillage if weeds do become a problem. Really, if weeds do become a problem with no-till organic soybeans, you got a choice either to deal with the weeds or you have to turn it under and do it conventionally. We have done that before. We had to make the decision to plow up an entire field that had rye and soybeans, and turned out the rain came at the wrong time and got very wet, and those weeds germinated, and it would have been a terrible mess. And we had to plant and work it conventionally anyway. But the other option is to use a planter, 30-inch spacing, where we could come in. If you do have an issue with weeds still, you do have an option to, you can either flame, you can flame the rows to burn down the weeds right in the row. And there's also, they make a what they call a no-till cultivator to get between the rows and provide you an opportunity. That'd be just another, as I mentioned before, piece of equipment in your toolkit or toolbox, depending on the situation, depending on what you're dealing with. If you're going to adapt or adopt to the changing conditions, it's a gamble, and you've got to be prepared for almost anything.
Okay, good. Anybody else want to weigh in? That's good.
We don't have near the experience or success that Steve and Bill have had with no-till. We dabbled with it one time, and we had a very big loss on it, mainly due to insect pressure, and it was about temperature, it was about rain and timing, and we missed the boat there. Conceptually, we like the idea. We'd like to figure out how to incorporate more of it, but part of our issue, being a dairy operation, is our rotation. You know, that cover crop, we're not just planting it and then turning it down as green manure, rolling it. We're harvesting it for cattle. So we need to do tillage on that ground prior to seeding it because we need that ground to be smooth so we can go in there to mow it, to harvest it, and free of debris. So that limits our ability there. Now, as we look at pasture acreage, we see a lot more opportunity there for no-till into existing crop. If we can run the cows across it, we can cut that one tillage pass out. If there's a little bit of debris there or the ground is not quite as smooth, she can handle that if she's harvesting it herself. So we do see some opportunity there, and we keep certainly watching Steve and Bill, trying to hope they get it nailed down and figured out so we can emulate them.
Okay. All right. We're getting close on time, but I do want to ask a couple more. As producers, do you see see a need for organic checkoff program that specifically would fund research and innovations for organics? I think something to think about since we're going to talk this afternoon about some research that's being done, and I know Michelle is looking for, you know, ideas of different research and things. So what do you think about that?
Well, I'll put my Maryland grain producer's hat on right now. So absolutely, I think that's I've never really thought of it that much until you just brought it up, really. I think that's a great idea. The checkoff program for the conventional acres and through Maryland Grain Producers is fantastic and funds a lot of research throughout the whole state, and a lot of this research is used on everyday farms, and that's the type of things that we need to do. So I think it is a fantastic idea for the organic program to participate in that as well.
Any other thoughts on that?
Yeah, I would agree with Evan. I think there's good opportunity for organic checkoff if we can make sure those dollars are headed into organic research.
Right. Yeah.
I know for us as a organic grain producer, we've had times where we've gone back and requested checkoff dollars back on organic acres.
Right.
Because at that point in time, those dollars weren't going towards research right. for organic.
Mm-hmm.
If there's a way to funnel that research, then yeah, I think it's a good opportunity.
Okay. All right, and let's do some closing thoughts. And there was one question about paperwork, so maybe you could talk about maybe a little bit of paperwork and some closing thoughts that you might have. So, Andrew, you want to start closing thoughts?
Well, I mean, that's a big part of the organic process is the paperwork, is making sure that the paperwork is correct. And so as a change from doing conventional chickens where you had not a lot of paperwork, there is more with the organic process. And of course, we have to be certified once a year and then also be GAP certified as well. So you have to have everything in line for that. You know, I've been accused of thinking through my back right pocket, my brain being hardwired there, and that's largely, you know, when I'm thinking about organic, that's a big part of the reason that I wanted to go that way was it seems like that's where the market is headed. We're in a good place in the Mid-Atlantic to take advantage of that market, and I'm all in favor of farmers making money however we best can. And so I think organic is going to be it's going to be big in this area.
Good.
For the produce market, like I said, we haven't certified the ground that we use for our vegetables, so I don't need to worry about paperwork with that. It's more just trying to get QuickBooks done with a three-year-old and a one-year-old constantly attached to my leg. So other than that, luckily right now, we don't have to worry about too much on that side. And for the grain, my dad actually still takes care of all of the paperwork right now, but I'm sure we'll learn more about that eventually as far as all the paperwork goes.
Yeah, I like to consider, Bill, I'd consider myself more the philosopher right now. I'm sure I'll make a change. Bill, I consider more the bean counter, but I know I'm going to have to get there and really hunker down with those books and all that the paperwork that Bill does. And, you know, it's all necessary. It's absolutely crucial. Just going back to my being a philosopher, the largest resource, I think I hinted on perhaps when I introduced myself, is the local organic farmers and the farming community in general. Without their assistance, their ingenuity, and the collective experience, that's what it's all about, is sharing our experiences, sharing our knowledge amongst each other, trying new things, and moving forward from there, we'll all be better stewards of the land when we're collaborating, communicating, and also we'll be able to protect the environment too. So I think that's, to me, that's the most important.
Okay. Matt.
From the paperwork standpoint, you know, the paperwork is significant. On the row crop, my father Ed handles most of that row crop paperwork. We felt like it's a lot of record keeping. It's not bad record keeping. Anytime you're keeping records, that's a good thing. But to be quite honest, as we're gearing into this transition for dairy, we thought it was a lot of paperwork before, and now my head swims with how onerous that paperwork is for moving an entire operation in like that, especially regarding milk production. So that's a definitely a new dynamic that is very time consuming, and you really do need somebody, depending on the scale of your operation, that can devote a lot of time to that. That is an offset there. As far as closing thoughts go, one of the things that Evan talked about here and their ability to negotiate a contract, I think it's important to know that the guys that sat up here this morning, they represent some really big businesses, and they have a lot of opportunity. But for them to capitalize on that opportunity, they need really good partners and people that they can count on. And these guys, they want to work with you. They want to see you succeed. Your success is going to be their success. And so it is, they're not out to get you. They're out to help you. And if they can help you, you can help them. And it is a good opportunity there, and especially for the region. There's between Pennsylvania, Southeast, and Central Pennsylvania in the organic marketplace there, and what Purdue's bringing into Delmarva. I see a lot of opportunity here in the future for it.
Okay, good. Evan?
Well, I'm now the guy, I've the youngest guy in the farm operation, and fresh out of college, and fresh out of the service, and fresh out of Lee, Maryland. I'm the guy who's handling a lot of this paperwork now. it's a necessary evil to be able to properly document what you do and what goes on your farm. I think it's very critical to do that, not only for organic but for a conventional side. If you can kind of develop a way to figure out what works best for you and your company, I've been working on that and kind of changed a few things, and it seems to be working pretty well as far as being able to document and kind of go off what you do, as well as fill out the necessary paperwork that you have to do each year. Kind of like a closing thought, I guess. I mentioned some a little bit of advice, kind of like on how to choose a field and whatnot. Working with Dr. Sears at Chino Farms, we're very conservation minded, and with James at Indian Town Farm, he does the same thing. A lot of the farms that we choose are strategically chosen based on kind of like erodible contents and like if it's surrounded by buffers and things like that. So if you're going to be doing like a lot of tillage and stuff that is involved with organic farming, it's very critical to choose the proper place to put your field in order to kind of stay within regulation and be a good steward to the environment. So that's all I got for that, and I appreciate the opportunity to talk to everybody, and good seeing everybody out here today. Thanks.
Good. All righty. Well, let's give
Jenny,
him a round of
real quick. I think if Evan started milking cows again, his dad would be happy to do the paperwork and put him outside.
Oh, there you go. So let's give our panel a round of applause. So thank you all very much.